This is your life. This is London Judo Society's HQ, and we're on our way, hoping to come to grips with someone who, when he wasn't much younger than these boys and girls here, suffered crippling illnesses and a very serious operation. Yet today, he's a super sporting star. Now, these boys and girls are, in fact, members of the judo club he runs in London's East End voluntarily, and at this very moment, he's just beyond here, preparing a demonstration for his television program, which he presents called Ace, and his opponent in that demonstration, who's in on our secret, is in fact Prince Vulton of the latest Flash Gordon film. But we know him better as Brian Blessed, the actor. Now, if we get right up here, so Brian is helping us, so quick as a flash, you add a further distraction while I pop around here and get to another entrance. All right, now let's see what happens. Brian, this unscheduled interruption to your program,
I don't believe it.
Is so that I can say, ace sportsman, Britain and European superstar, tonight, Brian Jacks, this is your life.
I'll kill my manager.
I'm glad it's never on me. I was terrified walking in.
It's lovely.
Thanks, Brian Blessed. Thank you, Brian. You're still in one piece. Well, I think we have a few more surprises that will maybe floor you a bit back at the theatre. We
don't understand that stuff. I mean, work like a maniac. I'm exhausted.
And you're all invited back to the theatre as well, of course, and see what surprises we have in store for
you.
Well done. Well, we certainly caught him on the hop, if not exactly on the mat. But right away, my thanks again, of course, for help from your old pal, Brian Blessed. Now, I know that you first came to grips on the judo mat in the early 60s when you became famous as Fancy Smith in that award-winning police series Zed Cars.
Yes, that's right. I mean, we first met at the judo choir in Orange Street, and Brian was a fantastic teacher. He was a constant inspiration to us all. I think the marvelous thing about Brian is that he does so much wonderful work for young people in judo and elsewhere, and I think this is so important today, and it's a great privilege to be with him on this program now.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Those children, in fact, you've got some 150 children at the moment. You couldn't believe they kept a secret.
I'm going to kill them all.
And that's where we met them, where in fact you began your own judo career. This is your life, Brian Jackson. Despite being floored by ill health as a youngster, you recovered from a crucial operation to dedicate yourself to becoming no less than super fit. You've won not once, but twice, the superstar title against the cream of British sporting talent. Here you are in 1979. First, it's paddle power and great technique as well in the canoeing. Next, pedal power, burning up the cycle track. Still full of bounce in the basketball test of skill. And look at this for sheer mind and muscle determination in the weightlifting. The Jack speciality, the arm dips. The superstar title in your sights and your bang on target. And when you took that title, Brian, no one applauded you more than the men who know firsthand the sheer determination that's needed. Of course, I mean your fellow competitors, and they're here. Top stars, everyone. World water ski champion Mike Hazelwood. Olympic oarsman Tim Crooks. Basketball player of the year Steve Ascender. And former European boxing champion Dave Boy Green. Thank you. Well, Brian, these days the world knows of your sporting talents, but you have another talent known only to your closest family. For the hands that hurl opponents all over the judo mat are also very artistic. Now, I didn't even know that until recently. You do quite a bit of drawing, don't you?
Yes, sir, yeah.
And very good drawing it is, too. Let me show you some for instances. Here's a drawing of yours, a cat. Isn't that lovely? Another one of a horse. And here's one more. Very romantic, this one. It's a kiss. Brian, who is kissing whom?
It's my wife.
Yeah. And you, of course. And of course she's here for an action replay, your wife, Julie. Well, Julie, it seems like this tough guy here is an old romantic at heart.
Well, I didn't think so when I first met him. Well, I met him in a Wimpy bar in Catford. And he walked in and he winked at me, so I winked back. And he immediately threw his phone number across the table to me. And I threw it back and I said, well, you know, if you want me, you'll have to ring me. Anyway, he found out my phone number and he rang me the very next day. And I refused to go out with him.
So he rang you again?
Well, he rang me every day for 3 weeks after that. And I finally decided to go out with him just to stop the phone calls.
I'm always trying to get what I want.
Well, clearly, Brian, your determination isn't confined to the sports arena, but I just want to mention your competitive spirit here again for a second because of the remarkable loyalty it inspires in your dedicated supporters. You were by no means alone, for instance, in Tel Aviv when you were about to take the European Superstar title for the second time. So keen are your supporters, Brian, that many of them travel around the world for you. But the heart of that traveling band of the Brian Jacks fan club is in London's East End. And if you look at that screen, Brian, I'm going to hail them now. Taxi! And the first cabbie, of course, your father, Albert.
Hello, Eamon. Hello, Brian. I have a few more people who would like to say hello to you.
Hi, Brian!
Hello, Brian!
You know, we've followed you all through England, Europe, in fact, all around the world, and people often see such a big group as this turn around and say, what are you, relations or something? And I turn around and say, yes, we are one big happy family. As you know, most of your uncles drive a London cab, and tonight we're taking no fares.
Wagon roll!
And here they come, your father Albert and mother Lillian. Sister Barbara and brother Shane.
What am I going to say?
Your dad is one of seven children, your mother one of 11, so wait for it, the greatest one-man fan club in sport. Your Uncle Alf and Aunt Eileen, Uncle Roy and Aunt Helen, Uncle Bill and Aunt Ivy, Uncle Ted, Aunt Esther, Uncle George, Aunt Nell, Uncle Flurry, Aunt Flurry. Uncle Charles, Uncle Sid, Aunt Catherine, Uncle Ron, Aunt Doreen, Uncle Len, Aunt Doris, Uncle Harry, Aunt Vera, Uncle Ron, and Aunt Doreen.
I can't believe it. I was with most of them last night.
All I can say is I'm glad I'm not looking for a cab right now in London. Brian, you were born into this great family on October the 6th, 1946, when the family home was at 124 Whitehorse Road, Stepney. And Lillian, though he looks healthy enough here, in fact, that was far from the case then.
Yes, he was a little weed. Little weed. Really, he was. All the baby illnesses he got. But he had to have a little bit more. He had a top hernia. It took me 8 years to find out what it was. They took him in, gave him a month's operation, and after that he came home a different child.
But Albert, those constant illnesses that really did take their toll on young Brian, didn't they?
They certainly did. I mean, looking at him now, you'd never think he was a weed as a child. But I was determined to get him built up because the area we come from is a little bit tough, like, and you have to look after yourself. So I was determined to get him in top condition, and I took him along to my judo club that I joined because I drive a cab around Saturday night in the London, and took him along there to teach him properly.
Well, thanks to your dad, you took to judo instantly, and we were shot here, taken a bit later on, of you showing someone just how much you've learnt. Who's that in the picture with you?
That's my father.
Going over your shoulder, yeah. Now, Dave Boy Green, you and, you know, Brian and his dad and so on gave you some help when, due to illness, a couple of years ago, Brian had to drop out of the World Superstars and you took his place.
That's correct, Damon. That's when I became one of the fantastic Jacks' family, when Brian and his brother Shane and his father gave me a lot of tuition for the World Superstars. And I think, you know, this just shows you what sort of a fella he is. He wanted me to do as well as what he did, you know, what he would have done if he'd have went to the World Superstars. And I'd like to say about his mother, you know, she's a real knockout for the grub. I think I'd have finished up in heavyweight.
Well, Brian, school days are at Forest Hill Comprehensive School, where the now by no means weedy youngster boxes for the school and is selected to play rugby for South East England schools. But even in those days, the age of only 12, there was that other side, the artistic side to your character. In fact, Albert, when he wasn't in the gym or on the sports field, he was still on the move, wasn't he?
He used to go around London in his school holidays with his friend, visiting art galleries and museums. That was his pastime, actually.
And he always went with this great school pal, didn't he?
He always had a great school pal with him.
Well, it's been a long time since you were last together with that
fellow. It's more than 20 years now, Brian, since I went to live in Australia.
But not in Australia tonight, because we've flown him the 14,000 miles from Melbourne to meet you again after 20 years, your old school days pal, Don Pope.
Fabulous.
Don, when we contacted you in Melbourne, the first thing you mentioned were those art gallery trips.
Yeah, well, you know, going back in those days, the things I can really remember about Brian was, I always remember going to watch him train at his judo club in Vauxhall, and during our school holidays, we used to jump on a bus and go around. And go around the museums. And even, you know, back in those days, I think his favourite one was the War Museum. You know, he was always pretty keen on fighting, the old Brian.
What happened when you went to Australia?
Oh, well, as soon as I got to Australia, I wrote to Brian. You know, it was one of the first things I did.
And what's more, he's kept the letter. And one of the things you wrote to Brian, Don, was, quote, "The day we moved into our new home was your birthday. By the way, many happy returns." And the date on that letter was the 4th of November, 1960.
Yeah, well, it certainly doesn't seem like 20 years, Brian. Yeah, that's right. Anyway, congratulations, mate. You've done pretty good seeing as you're a pom.
Thank you, Don Pope. Well, Barbara, of course, you'd early experience of your brother Brian's enthusiasm for painting.
Yes, quite earlier on. When we moved into a house many years ago, I think Brian was about 3 and I was about 6 months old. I don't really remember it. My parents had told me so many times, and he decided to start his career then. We had the painters in, and he decided to do some painting of his own. He first of all started with the carpet, then the curtains, and then his Jeep and his bicycle. Then he decided to start on me, through the cot, I might add, and he painted me a beautiful pea green colour. And that's when it all started, his painting.
Now, Aunt Doreen in the front row there, where's Aunt Doreen? There you are, yes. Well, and just a year later, Brian was, I believe, page boy at your wedding when he was only 3 years old.
Yes, Eamon. Brian was all dressed up in his top hat, walking stick. Everybody was lined up to have their photographs taken. Brian's missing. Finally, we discovered he was doing the call of nature in his top hat. But he did empty it before he put it back on.
Very sensible of him indeed. Well, later on, both Barbara and Shane went along to judo classes, and Shane, Brian's example must be quite something to follow in the sporting scene.
That's right, Eamon, it is. But I'd do my best. But one example I've learnt from him is, as a youngster, he did a lot of sports, some of them from water skiing to rugby, as you've already mentioned, all sorts of sports, and he got so many broken bones in his body that even the ambulance man, who used to come around and pick him up when he was little, got to know him, and they let him sit in the front of the ambulance and ring the bell on the way to the hospital.
It was all worthwhile when your advancing judo expertise brings you to the opportunity at the age of 15 to study and train in judo at the very heart of the ancient art in Tokyo. The invitation comes through the London Judo Society because the Japanese have asked for the best youngster it's got. But of course it's going to cost money. So Lillian, what did you have to do?
Well, it's a hard struggle, but he always got his own way. We granted him his wish. Daddy just bought a new car, £240. So
he sold the new car.
Pardon?
He sold the new car.
He sold the new car.
Well now, and this was to get your air ticket. You took a job yourself, didn't you?
I took a job myself as a lady chef with BOAC. Daddy sold the car. We got Brian's air ticket, and he got
And we have
his
a
wish.
Picture of the air ticket because you've kept it there. That's the air ticket to Tokyo as your mother kept to this day. But it says £242. That's £2 short, Albert. Where do the other two come from?
We saved that up.
So you're off to Tokyo, but working out at daily mass training sessions like this at the legendary Kodokan Judo Center gives you an appetite that the frugal Japanese diet of rice doesn't always fill, so you look out for any odd jobs to earn money for a good tuck-in. In fact, one of those jobs was behind the counter at a snack bar in a tough district of Tokyo where the customers weren't always appreciative about your service.
Oi!
Oh, I've no idea what that means, but to tell us, the only other British youngster with you on that judo course in Tokyo 17 years ago, yes, your old pal, Bobby Bolton. Bobby, roughly, what did you say there?
Well, that was Brian's ice cream. It's bloody awful.
Well, did he get many complaints from the customers?
No, he's really quite good, you know, but occasionally when we did have a problem, he'd just stroll across and pour a bucket of water over him just to keep him quiet.
Really?
Yeah.
Thank you very much, Bobby Walton. We have. Must have been a very posh place you were working in.
It weren't very posh at all, I'm afraid. But it was money at that particular time.
And
Bob
wet.
And I used to live on a bar of chocolate every couple of days because the Japanese food weren't so good.
Well, after 2 years in Japan, good or not, you returned to Britain in 1963 a judo black belt, and already good enough at the age of 17 to be brought into the Great Britain team for the Olympic Games the following year in the city of Tokyo. But of course, though training flat out, you need to get a job. And you get a part-time job at a garage which maintains London cabs.
You not only got the job, but you got a new name as well. Remember, we called you Lena.
Yes, garage owner and ex-cabbie, also great Brian Jacks fan, Ken Callahan. Now, Ken, what's all this about calling Europe's superstar Lena?
Well, the idea of the job was that Brian could work in the mornings and train the afternoons and the evenings for the Tokyo Games. And the trouble was that when he came in the mornings, the training had taken so much out of him that you give him a job to do and he'd be leaning over the cab. And he's the only guy I know that can sleep standing up. In fact, I used to wake him up to give him his wages.
I used to enjoy fixing the wheel so I could lay underneath the cab just to lay there.
This is how he got the name.
Yeah, he was a leaner.
Thank you, Ken Callahan. Well, you are neither leaning nor sleeping when the Olympics open in Tokyo, for although you are the baby of the judo team, you're the only member of the British squad actually to win a match. And by the 1972 Olympics in Munich, you're made team captain and take the bronze. And here tonight, Olympic colleagues from Tokyo and Munich, those great friends of yours, Tony Sweeney, Alan Pepperbridge. Sydney Hall. Eddie Mullen. Bobby Sullivan. Silver medalist Keith Renfrey and Dave Starbrook. And Jerome's star pupil, flown in from Paris, Moscow gold medalist Angelo Parisi. I'd be afraid to embrace a judo expert like that. Returning from Munich, Brian, you go to teacher training college in Woolwich, specializing in physical education. But, Julie, before that, the Olympic bronze medal winner had a touch of gold to present to you.
Yes, Eamon, I proposed him when he came back, and he accepted. This was my gold I got from him.
That's your gold, and very nice it is, too. And there you are at your wedding at Caxton Hall on November the 4th, 1972. But, Brian, just before we close, I'd like to take you back 16 years to the crucial bout you fought to get into the Great Britain Olympic team, a bout which Lillian reduced you to tears.
Well, I was really. It was hard bout. It dwindled down to two left, one was to go. Brian fought very hard. And I was praying that he would win, but I felt very, very sorry for the fella lost. I really felt sorry, and I had a good cry. I really cried.
Well, it was a very narrow win, but it was a win. And 10 years ago, Brian, that great pal of yours that made your mother cry because you beat him went to train in Tokyo and liked it so much, he made his home there. But he's not there tonight because we've flown him 8,500 miles to be here. Yes, as you said, Tony Orton.
Man that can proudly say he actually took a full point off of me when he strangled me once in a competition.
And it's all of 9 years since you two lads met, Tony.
More or less that, yes.
That was in Tokyo.
It was in Tokyo. That was before Brian went for the Munich Olympics, came over and trained there, and I'd been told that he was going to come over, somebody told me, but I didn't know exactly when. And I was sitting down one night, minding my own business, and there was a knock on the door, a telegram. And announced that Brian and Keith and Angelo would be arriving at 11:30. This was 11:15, so I just waited there. I just sat down. There's nothing I could do. Telephone rang, picked it up. Hello, Brian. I said, how do you know it's me? I said, well, you're the only fellow who'll send me a telegram and 15 minutes later arrive after 8,000 miles.
Thank you, Tony Orton. Well, now, Brian, in order to beat Tony in that vital bout that Lillian was talking about for Olympic selection, you put in some special training with a judo club member who made the most demands on your muscle power for the simple reason he was the biggest and heaviest opponent you could find. And I know what a tough time he gave you in training. You haven't seen him for some years now, but there's one young guy who's been looking for that same Tiny Wilson to exact revenge on your behalf.
Crikey, the ice cream man.
Hello, Brian. Recognize the slimline lock? I've come down from 22 stone to 19. And that guy's caught up with me at last.
Yes, you're 18 old son Philip.
I should have known better than to tangle with the Jacks.
But recovered in time to be here, your old pal Tony Wilson, and that future champ, your son Philip. Come on to that. She sees your photograph. Brian Jacks, sporting superstar, this is your life. Well done, Philip.